Yep. That's what it's about.
As far as Rod, what were the lessons learned from him, from you guys? I know you all weren't under him, but that connection binds you guys.
Well, I both played for Rod and coached for him. And actually, when I played for him, to be honest, I thought he was old then. And 20 years later, I go back and I'm coaching for him, and he had more energy than any person I've ever been around. Because he had Dart trucking. In fact, I was the athletic director at Dart Transportation for several years. That's how I made a living. But Rod was, as far as the X's and O's, he was good, but the thing that he was unbelievable at was making you believe in yourself and making you believe in your teammates, and that you guys, we're not going to win. And that's why the game with Dave Winfield and other games, there was a game at what, Cal State LA, where they just pulled the guy off the bag of turning the double play to end a regional playoff, which we would have lost. Well, they didn't get it out, so they don't get this out, and they lose the game. But that kind of mentality that Rod instilled in us was, you know, you're not going to lose. We're never going to lose. And the attention to detail, we were talking about infield and stuff like that, and ground balls and double plays in the meeting with the kids. We used to practice infield like crazy because of one of the things that we would do. When teams would come in here, we would take infield first. And there wasn't a ball dropped, there wasn't a missed throw, there was nothing, because we practiced. And they come out on the field, and as soon as they dropped one, here come the bench jockey. And half the time, the games are over before we made through the first pitch. Seriously. But it's, he was a mentor to me even when I went into pro ball and I was a pitching coach and I was managing, and I still would talk to Rod. And he always had made a way of you feeling strong about yourself and feeling positive. And I think that's the thing that carries through. You don't feel like you're going to lose. And we didn't lose to the Bruins either. And by the way, one of his other comments was, you're a Trojan. You're a Bruin for 4 years. You're a Trojan for life. And that's the way we all are.
All-American Jerry Feldman passed away 2 Christmases ago.
Mark, what about you? What did you learn from Ron?
Well, I think we all obviously can't do any more, but he used to have this little notepad up there called the Boulevard Boners. And so, this is when I was a freshman, right? So, I always, because of this, I've learned how to stand and attention during the national anthem. So, it was one of the first games, and we're standing at anyways. And so a buddy and I were just talking during the national anthem, and then all of a sudden I go back after it's over with. I go, he's riding on the Boulevard Boners up there, and at the time, as you guys probably have heard the stories, he doesn't really know your name. He calls you Tiger. Well, and I figured out he didn't know my name, because he wrote on the board up there, he wrote McGraw. And then right next to it, he said, Communist. Because of that, I've always stood attention to the national anthem.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Yeah, and then one other, so back in the day when we used to fly, I don't know how you guys fly. Do you fly charters now? Do you guys fly charters? Or still, do you guys fly charters, or do you guys fly Southwest and stuff?
Southwest, commercial.
So we did that same thing, right? So he would always, after a Sunday game, he'd always take us out to dinner before the flight, and he'd always get us a bucket of suds. And that was really good. Some beers and shit. And he goes, hey, we say, Tigers, Tigers, Tigers. Spend a dime more, you always get first class. And I've never forgot that. And I still say that to this day. So you guys remember that. You spend a dime more, you always get first class. So if you take care of your players, you're going to get, players are going to take care of you later. So he was absolutely wonderful. And then he would always come and visit. I think Dave and Roy and all you guys can attest, when guy, we would come into the town to play the Dodgers, him and Tommy were tight, and here we'd come in with his fantastic cane. It was a baseball bat, and he had all his players sign his baseball bat. It was the most wonderful thing, and I'll tell you what, it's just, when you would just brighten up and just smile every time you'd see him because he still didn't know my name. He just, Tiger, great to see you. Tiger, great to see you.
No, he didn't.
No, I'm just kidding. So, but anyways, that's just one of the hundreds of stories that I have from being here. But it was all fantastic.
Coach Stank said that you're even driving in runs. You're either driving in runs or you're bringing in runs. Brett, you're fourth on the Trojans' RBI list. What was the key to your success in college?
I'll tell you, I didn't have a clue. I came here with my hair on fire, and I just winged it. I really did. And a big part of my big league career, too, I just got there with my hair on fire, and I winged it. I'll tell you, SC, and I hear these stories about Rod. And I got here the year after Rod stepped down, and I had Gillespie in his first year, or maybe it was Gillespie's second year, but Rod was still really close to the program. And I got to be around him, and as Mark was saying, Mark played for him, and he barely knew his name. Well, he really didn't know my name, but it was the Tiger, the Tiger, the Tiger. He could work a room. I remember Rod, you know, at banquets or events when he'd be the keynote speaker, and he was just, he was one of those guys. They broke the mold for a Rod Dedeaux. But and then I ended up having some real fun years, and he passed recently. But my coach, Mike Gillespie, he was wonderful. The thing about SC when I came here is the history. It's almost like when you look at the national championship, it's almost like the New York Yankees of college baseball. And that's what I did. Never got a chance to win one. Got really close twice. Never even got to go to the World Series. Had to lose twice. Back-to-back regionals, not to go to the College World Series, and we went 0-2 and 0-2. So, close but no cigars, had a great time here. My brother went here, my daughter went here, and it's still something I got over my dad, who's a Stanford guy. So, he always wants to talk about Stanford. You know, my son went to Princeton, so I got a Princeton, I got a Stanford, and then us SE guys hang together. Me, my brother, and my daughter, so... It's something. I came here not knowing anything about history and just this SC family and the fight on, and I came out of here. I think Marcel said it, you're a Trojan for life, so nothing but great, great memories.
Jeff, you were part of the...
Just one more thing. He was not lying to you when he said, I just go up there, because when he was with Seattle and we were trying to put scouting reports against him, there was none. He swings at everything, he hits at everything. It doesn't make any difference.
That's the best offense, don't know how to attack it. Jeff, as far as you, in 1995, you led USC to its first College World Series appearance since, I believe, 1978. What was part of that team that you guys were able to turn the tide?
Well, that team was pretty incredible. Obviously, any good team has, a good camaraderie, whatever, and all the guys love each other, and that was no different. But there was just something different about that team. We actually ended up having nine guys playing the big leagues off that one team. Some lengthy, some not as lengthy, but we had guys like Bobby Kilty that was a water polo player that was a pitcher on our team, and all of a sudden he's hitting in the big leagues, switch hitting. So we just had a lot of talent. Morgan Ensberg was on the bench on that team, I believe, that year. He was a freshman. We had Booney. And one of the coolest things for me, by the way, is my brother played with Brett at USC, and so I was kind of a little Trojan in the making, and I got to come out and watch all these guys play in the regionals, and for me it really baited the hook, because I was out here and I was one of the guys yelling and ragging Dan Chalowski at third base from Cal or whoever it was, right? I was out there ragging right along with the guys, so I knew I wanted to be a Trojan from day one. It was a no-brainer to follow my brother's footsteps, but again, that 1995 team, just battled. We obviously lost the final game, but no regrets. I remember waking up on the final day, looking at my roommate, looking at Gabe, and saying, man, can you believe that we are playing for the national championship right now? And that's a special feeling that you guys want to feel.
It's interesting because the common thread, obviously, between all you guys is winning at every level. I was curious if there's a common theme you found to winners. What are the characteristics of winners? I know it's a deep question, but I'm curious.
Well, they're dedicated people. They're people that are not afraid to out. You're going to outwork the other guy. That's part of your mentality. You're going to work harder. You're going to spend more time. You're not going to try and take any shortcuts. And the attention to detail. There's, as I said, Rod was big with it, but the coaches, Roy's uncle Gene Mock was a manager that I worked for in the major leagues, one of the smart, probably the smartest baseball person I've ever been around. His attention to detail was unbelievable. And all the really good players, David, and all the guys, attention to detail. There's no detail too small. As soon as you start thinking it's too small, it's the one that's going to beat you.
Anyone else?
I agree with that. I mean, I didn't like the days that with Rod, we'd spend a half an hour at first base and talk about how to get a lead off and do all this stuff and go to second base and how to get a lead off at second base, go to third base. You know, as a young kid, I want to, you know, get the bag, put my gloves on, I want to hit, right? But as you listen to the detail and you go throughout your career, that means a lot. I mean, you have to learn how to make the routine play. You got to learn how to make to cut the corner right. I wasn't a very fast base runner, but I was a very efficient base runner. And these are the things that are ingrained, that Rod ingrained to us. Just the detail stuff, just going in the cage and getting your work done. You know, back then there wasn't a lot of cage stuff, but I found out doing that by myself. Today, the kids are finding yourself in the cage all the time. But I mean, it's the ground balls were huge. I mean, I was lucky enough to win a gold glove in the big leagues, and it goes all the way back here to make the routine play. You got to be able to make the routine play. I play with a lot of guys in the big leagues that can make great plays, but they can't make the routine play. And what usually adds runs on the scoreboard for the other team is when you can't make a routine play. So how boring it is to make a routine play. You got to be good at making the routine play. And it all started right here. Right on this field, first base, second base, third base, cutoff and relays. Unfortunately, today in the game today, they don't do enough of that. I'm sure they do it here in college, but they don't do it enough. They don't do the infield work and stuff. You didn't like it, but you look back. Now I look back 42 years ago when I walked in the stadium like this. That was the time that it started ingraining. So a lot of great memories from this field.
Any other thoughts?
Yeah. I think, you know, just accountability is a big word for me, and he's talking about routine. I think the minute that I figured out my routine as a player, and my routine is not your routine. You guys got to find out what works out for you on an everyday basis. And I think as soon as you find that routine, with that routine that you do on an everyday basis comes the statistics and the consistency, and with the accountability part, for me, you know, it's about not making excuses. Take responsibility for what you do on that field. Because if you have success, you take responsibility. So you better take success for when you make mistakes. So just be consistent, have a great routine, and take accountability.
As far as what makes a winner, you know, I'll take a little bit of a different... I'll have a little bit of a different take. When I looked at players throughout my career, college career, professional career, the guys I looked to were not the guys that talked a lot. I didn't listen for what people said. It's the guys I gravitated towards and guys I wanted to be like were the guys that walked the walk. The guys that did it right, and you look at them and go, I want to be like him. What makes him different? Those were the winners to me. The guy that I come to the ballpark and I can't tell what happened the night before. You know, in sports, and it's so hard, especially as young players, because it's emotional, and you learn as you get a little maturity and you get some experience in this game, you learn how to kind of get to a point where you could level out. Now, as a young player, I was, man, up and down. You could tell if I had a good game, bad game. But as I went on and I watched the guys, when I got to the big leagues and I watched the veterans on my team that I respected, how did they carry themselves? You know, anybody can do cartwheels, turn the music real loud when you got four hits and you just rattled off four or five. But I want to see the guy when you just lost six straight and you're one for your last 13. Are you that same guy? And the guys I looked to and guys I respected the most were the guys that kind of stayed along that even keel. Yeah, I'm not saying not enjoy success, of course. I don't want you frowning when you got a base hit to win the game and you just swept the series. But I don't want to see in the corner sucking your thumb when you're one for your last 15 and you're getting your butt kicked. That's not the guy I want. I want that guy that's kind of here. And those are the guys I gravitated towards. And as I became an older player and a veteran player, I tried to be that guy for my teammates.
You know, all this stuff is so great. I bring it back personally to something Latch said about how Rod made you feel like you were always going to win. And I think about that. About that thread, winners expect to win. I think that's what winners do. They expect to win. Now, there's a lot of building blocks to that. They expect to win because they've they've done all of the fundamentals, you know, forever and ever till they were, you know, sick to death of them. But when it had to happen in the game to win the game, they were able to do whatever it is, the bunt play or the hit and run or the relay or whatever it was. They expect to win because they know what kind of team, what kind of players, what kind of preparation that they have. But they also can expect to win, and when it's really a big game, when it's a tough pitcher, when, whatever it is, the winners look at it as an opportunity to do something great, rather than being, oh no, you know, what if I fail? And I think Rod knew that about it intrinsically, because he was so hard on us. You talk about the Bovard boners, the fines, you know, it and he said to me when I came here to play shortstop, he said, you know, I'll never get on you for making an error. You know, people make errors. But, you know, you got to move your feet. You got to learn how to make sure that you're moving your feet all the time to be in position. But, you know, I'm not going to get on you for making errors. I made an error one game. I came in. He's writing Smalley 25 cents on what I said. I went up to him, and I said, Coach, I just made an error. I mean, I hadn't made one in 20 games. I mean, I thought you weren't going to fine anybody for making an error. He goes, I'm not fining you for making an error. I'm fining you for not moving your feet. I go, okay, well, that was it. And he put so much, I mean, I don't know what you guys thought, but as I got away from it, I thought that fine system and the reasons that he had, that he gave you for what they were and how they related to practice and how they related to games and what you did in both of those things, it put so much pressure on us. I really felt like when we got in big games, it was less pressure than an everyday practice with Rod. I really did. I just felt like we were tough. And Rod had made it that way, and I think that's a threat.
Yeah, we had some really good teams, and to have a clean sheet on the Bovard Boner book would happen maybe four or five times during the whole year, because it was, I mean, there was, you couldn't get, if you walked the leadoff hitter, if you walked a hitter with two outs from a pitching standpoint, if you dropped the ball, the most minute things, when I'm talking about detail, that would be on the list. So to play a perfect game was amazing. And when we did it, it was like, whoa, everybody. And the first find of the day was a buck. And in those days, a buck was. And the other ones would be the nickel, dime. But the fact that they were up there and you knew about them, that's what it put it in your head, like Roy's saying. Now you knew, you started to know how to play the game.
All right, and we talked about the past here at Dedeaux Field. I want to invite Jeff Fucci up to talk about the future of Dedeaux Field. But before he comes up, can everyone just give a round of applause for these Trojan legends that came to join us tonight? Thank you guys so much. Jeff, do you want to take it over? He's going to talk about what to expect next.